promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never
all of our days is for your glory. We follow all the way and raise your hands. All your nations shout to God, all creation. How awesome is the Lord Most High. And we will praise you together for now forever. How awesome is the Lord Most High. Where you send us, God, we will go. And you're the answer we want the world to know. We'll trust you when you call our name. And where you lead us, we'll follow all the way. Raise your hands, all you nation. Shout to God, all creation. How awesome is the Lord Most High. And we will praise you together, for now and forever. How awesome is the Lord Most High.
Sing hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. How awesome is the Lord Most High. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, how awesome is the Lord Most High.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah, how awesome is the Lord Most High. Raise your hands, all you nations. Shout to God, all creation. How awesome is the Lord Most High. We will praise you together, for now and forever. How awesome is the Lord Most High.
morning. Welcome to everybody who's here visiting. Welcome to people who've been here for a long time. Welcome to everybody watching online. Welcome, welcome, welcome. How awesome is the Lord Most High? And I just, as I was singing that, I was just singing like kind of praying that over us today, that we would really believe that and mean that and see that in our lives, that we would see that in the world around us, that we'd see that no matter the circumstances, no matter what's going on, that we would see how awesome is the Lord Most High. And so I just pray that over you this morning. If there's something here that's making you doubt that or struggle with that this morning, I pray that God would open your eyes to that. If you're in a place where your life's full of joy, just that you would reflect on where that joy comes from, but that we would just be praising and how awesome is the Lord Most High. A couple of announcements. So first one is, I've had these last couple weeks, these cards, there's still some in the back. For anybody that would like to be a part of a fellowship groups that we're starting, where you're committing to meet for like 2 hours a month with a group of people for the next like 8 months. I think that's right. Yeah, 8 months. And so if you'd like to be a part of one of those groups, this is kind of your last chance to do that. I mean, actually, probably not. If you want to talk to us later, we'd probably get you into a group. But it would be ideal if you would do it today. So grab a card at the back and put it, drop in the offering box, and then we're going to try to get in those groups split up and moving the process forward in those. So I encourage you to do that if you haven't done that yet. Also, last week, Doug Lang was here, talked about the food drive for The Bridge, which is a community service organization out in Birch Bay that we support. And so they're kind of doing a push for food for their food bank there. So if you have any canned goods or non-perishable items that you can bring in to donate, we have a bin in the back there that you can bring those in for that. And then on Tuesday, October 29th, Wacom Dream is going to be putting on an Understanding Poverty workshop, and it helps us to gain a deeper understanding and a perspective of those that are living in poverty. Jesus encourages us and teaches us to reach out to the least of these, and so to be able to understand the mindset for something that a lot of us have by God's grace, not experienced, to be able to reach people and love people more effectively. So I encourage you to think about being a part of that. It's really enlightening and helpful. So that's October 29th at the CAP Center. So you can RSVP and sign up for that at Blaine Cap. If you email Blaine Cap, there's flyers in the back. You should probably just grab one of those, and that's the best way to do it. Follow the directions. So, yeah. All right. So I think with all of that, let's pray, and then we'll come back to worship. God, how awesome is the God Most High God? We sing that. We sang that, and I pray just that would be true for us, God. Not true for us that what we think changes who you are, but that we would see who you are. We would see you in your awesomeness, God. And so I just pray for that this morning, God, that wherever we're at, whether our lives are in a difficult spot or in a great spot, that wherever we're at, that we would see your awesomeness, we would see your faithfulness, we would see your love, and that we would praise you now, God. May our voices just be lifted up to you. God, just anything that's keeping us from freely worshiping you, whether it's if it's our sin, we can confess those to you. If it's our if it's just our mindsets and struggles, may we just lay those before you. Whatever it is that's keeping us from freely worshiping you, God, may we just come before you and lay those aside and worship you and see you in your awesomeness this morning. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let's all stand in the presence of our loving God and sing his praises together. Your love's so great, Jesus, in all things. I've seen a glimpse of your heart a billion years, and still I'll be singing. How can I praise you enough? Oh, how I praise you enough. You are the Lord. You are the Lord Almighty.
outshining all the stars in glory. And your love is like the wildest ocean. Oh, nothing else compares. Creation calls all to the Savior. We are alive for your praise. In earth and sky, no one is higher. Our God of wonders, you reign. Our God of wonders, you reign. Yeah, and you are the Lord Almighty, outshining all the stars in glory. And your love is like the wildest ocean. Oh, nothing else compares. 'Cause you are the Lord Almighty, outshining all the stars in glory. And your love is like the wildest ocean. Oh, nothing else compares. To us, not to us, but to your name, we lift up all praise. Not to us, but to your name, we lift up all praise. Not to us, but to your name, we lift up all praise. Not to us, but to your name, we lift up all praise. You are the Lord Almighty, now shining all the stars in glory. And your love is like the wildest ocean. Oh, nothing else compares. 'Cause you are the Lord Almighty, outshining all the stars in glory. And your love is like the wildest oceans. Oh, nothing else compares. You are the Lord Almighty, outshining all the stars in glory. Your love is like the wildest ocean. Oh, nothing else compares. Times I've failed, still your mercy remains. Should I stumble again, still I'm caught in your grace. Everlasting, your light will shine when all else fades. Never ending, your glory goes beyond all faith. Your will above all else. art of losing myself in bringing you grace everlasting. Your light will shine when all else fades, never ending. Your glory goes beyond all things. In my heart and my soul, Lord, I give you control. Consume me from the inside out, Lord. Let justice and praise become my embrace, to love you from the inside out. Will above all else, my purpose remains. The art of losing myself in bringing you praise everlasting. Your light will shine when all else fades, never ending. Your glory goes beyond all. Yeah, in my heart and my soul, Lord, I give you control to consume me from the inside out, Lord. Let justice and praise become my embrace, to love you from the inside out. Your light will shine when all else fades, never ending. Your glory goes beyond all faith, and the cry of my heart is to bring you praise from the inside out, Lord, my soul. And my soul, Lord, I give you control, consume me from the inside out, Lord. Let justice and praise become my embrace, to love you from the inside out, everlasting. Your light will shine when all else fades, never ending. Your glory goes beyond all fame, and the cry of my heart is to bring you praise from the inside out, Lord. My soul cries out from the inside. Cries out,
before there was light, walked across the pages of time. He who made every living thing, behold him. He who heard, who humanity's cry. Left his throne to wake as a child. He became like the least of us. Behold him, Jesus, Son of God, Messiah, the Lamb, the roaring lion. Oh, be still and behold him. He who dined with sinners and saints, heal the blind, the lost, and the lame. Even now he is in our midst. Behold him. He who chose a criminal's end, paid with blood to settle our debts, buried death as he rose to life. Behold him, Jesus, Son of God, Messiah, the Lamb, the roaring lion. Oh, be still and behold him, Jesus, Alpha and Omega, our God, the risen Savior. Oh, be still and behold him. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. Worthy, worthy, worthy to receive all praise. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. Worthy, worthy, worthy to receive all praise. Sing to the Lord. Oh, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. Worthy, worthy, worthy to receive all praise. Oh, and Jesus, Son of God, Messiah, the Lamb, the roaring lion. Oh, be still and behold him, Jesus, Alpha and Omega, our God, the risen Savior. Oh, be still and behold him, Jesus, Alpha and Omega, our God, the risen Savior. Oh, be still and behold him.
thank you, yeah. And thankful for that too, and thankful for the prayer of the church around the world for our nation and for us. Yeah, so thank you. Thank you for sharing that, Rod. I also do still feel led though, like just like of want to hear testimonies of God's work in our lives as well. So thank you for that, Rod. Yeah, Joe? Any other ways you can go to work? Yeah, Debbie. Else, any other testimonies of ways that God has changed you? Thank you for those that share. Let's just go back to God in prayer. God, we just thank you for the ways that you are at work, for the ways that you shape us, God. God, the ways that you change us to make us more like you, the ways you work in our hearts, God. God, that the power of the one who raises up and tears down nations, God, is at work in us, God. And so, God, we ask just that we would be yielded to you as your people, God. God, I pray that you'd help us to hear what you want us to hear from these testimonies, to be encouraged by them, to be empowered by them, just to remember the strength of you who work, God. And God, may we just submit our lives to you. May we trust you to work mightily, God. God, we thank you for those around the world that are lifting us up and lifting our nation up today, God. God, we pray that we would just be partnered, God, and with them in prayers for us, for our nation, and especially for your kingdom to be established, God. God, I pray just that we would have a mindset of looking to you, the ruler of all, the ruler of the world, the ruler of our lives, and that our lives would be submitted to you. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you, guys. If you'd like to worship in giving, there's the offering box at the back, or online from the church website, or bcfgiving.churchcenter.com. And thank you for all those who have continued to give. And I think let's go ahead and dismiss kids for kids' church. So preschool through second grade in the prime room, and third through fifth grade in the youth room.
All right, so we're going to continue today in the book of John, and having a little trouble up here. Here we go. Sorry about that. And still having some trouble. I'm going to get this tablet over here. Sorry, my slides aren't working there. Can you give me that tablet, eh? All right, so continuing in the book of John today, so we've been where Jesus has had this conversation with Nicodemus, who was a Pharisee, a religious leader, and we've been talking about Jesus' conversation with him, and last week kind of unpacked probably the most famous verse in Scripture of that this is how God loved the world, that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him will not perish but have everlasting life. And so he unpacked that and talked about it as an expression of God's love, and then finished up the conversation with Nicodemus. And we're going to go forward today, and actually before I really introduce the passage, I just actually want to read the beginning of the passage of how John introduces it and then talk about this. So just go ahead and open up to chapter 3, and we're going to start in verse 22. So it says, "After this, Jesus' disciples went into the Judean countryside, and he remained there with them, and he was baptizing. John also was baptizing at Aenon near Salim, because water was plentiful there, and people were coming and being baptized, for John had not yet been put in prison. Now a discussion arose between some of John's disciples and a Jew over purification, and they came to John and said to him, 'Rabbi, he who was with you across the Jordan, to whom you bore witness, look, he is baptizing, and all are going with him, are going to him.'" So John the Baptist is back, so this is the second time in the Gospel of John that we've talked about John the Baptist, and it's confusing because there's these Johns. So there's John who wrote the book of John, and then there's John the Baptist, and that's who this passage is talking about. So John, the writer of the Gospel, is writing about John the Baptist, and I'll try to keep those straight today. But what's interesting about this is, I'm not going to get into the reasons why, but when you look at this real closely, this probably is not in chronological order here. Like, it says, like, after this, here, but really, like, in Greek, you translate it as with this, like, and it's not, like, an implied, like, this happens sequentially, but we see a lot of times the gospel writers that they arrange their material kind of thematic, somewhat chronologically, but also thematically. And I think there's a reason here that we had John in the first chapter, John the Baptist, and now after this conversation with Nicodemus, of all the things that John, the writer of John, could have chosen to talk about, he chose to talk about John the Baptist. And why does he do that? And I think that goes back to, if you remember when we first introduced Nicodemus, it was actually at the end of chapter 2 and then end of chapter 3, we said that Nicodemus represented those with insufficient faith. That the end of chapter 2, it says many people are coming to Jesus, and they believed in Jesus, but Jesus did not entrust himself, did not believe himself into them. And we talked about how Nicodemus was a picture of a faith that did not have a life transformed, that it might intellectually, like, said something about Jesus, but didn't trust in Jesus in the fullness of who he was. And I think that John the Baptist is now placed in this conversation right after Nicodemus to kind of contrast that. That Nicodemus is a picture of faith that's not sufficient, but that in John's response to Jesus, we see a picture of faith that is sufficient. And so what I want to look at as we look at John today is I want to look at him as an example. We saw Nicodemus as an example of what not to be. And what do we see in John an example of what to be? What does sufficient faith look like? And, you know, I always get into this when you talk about faith. Like, obviously, it's not about our works. Like, that's key to what we believe as Christians is that it's not about our work. And so when we say sufficient faith, it's not faith that is doing all of these things, but it's faith that bears itself out this way in our life. When we see a faith that bears the fruit that we see in John's life. And so it's for us to examine our own hearts, examine our own faith, our own belief. Is it producing the kind of fruit that we see in John's life? So with that kind of introduction, let's go ahead and jump in here, I guess. So it says that John is out in the countryside, and people come to him his disciples come to him because a controversy arises. And it says this controversy is over. Did anybody catch what it was over? Purification. It's right here. Yeah, sorry. Over purification. And it's kind of weird because this is the only mention of this. So now John's going to have a conversation with his disciples. They came to him and said, we're told there's a controversy of purification. They come to him. Do they mention anything about purification? No, they don't say anything about purification. They say, hey, Jesus and his disciples are out there baptizing, and we find out later it's really just Jesus' disciples. John clarifies that for us later. But that Jesus' disciples are out there baptizing, and everyone's going to them. So that for them, the confrontation, the question they have is, hey, everybody's going over there. John, you're losing influence. You're losing your following. These people are no longer looking to you. They're looking to Jesus, right? And so purification is not mentioned again in this passage. And then his disciples present to him a different problem. And we're going to come back to that towards the end, so just kind of keep that nugget in your mind. But it's interesting that this is the way that this whole conversation is framed that John tells us about here. And so John's response when his disciples come to him and say, you're losing influence, people are going and following Jesus instead of following you, this is the way that John responds to that. He says, John answered, a person cannot receive even one thing unless it's given him from heaven. You yourselves bear me witness that I said, I am not the Christ or the Messiah, but I have been sent before him. So this kind of echoed some words that John had back in chapter 1. But what's interesting here is that John's response is not, it's kind of a response to the question, but it's really just kind of like a little saying, right? Like it almost sounds like a little something out of Proverbs or something like that. A person can't have anything unless it's given to him from God, right? John doesn't directly address, so his disciples come to him and say, hey, everyone's going to Jesus, and he says, well, a person can't have anything unless it comes from God, right? He's wanting them to apply this truth principle of life to this situation, to this problem that they're seeing, and it's an interesting response because it's kind of an obvious principle, right? If you believe in God, and you believe that God is all-powerful, And then you believe that anything that you have or that anybody has comes from God. And so it's not that he's even teaching them something new. He's reminding them of something that they already know. Something that he would have probably taught them, something that he would have lived his life on, is that everything we have comes from God. And so anybody that goes, sees Jesus, well, that's from God. Anybody that follows me, that's from God. Whatever I have is from God. And so the very first place that he points his disciples in this conflict reveals something about his faith, about his trust, is that sufficient faith trusts God. Sufficient faith trusts God. John says, whatever happens, whatever influence I do and don't have, that's from God. Whoever listens to me, whoever doesn't listen to me, that's from God. Whatever material things I have or don't have, that's from God. Right? Like, this is kind of the basis of everything else that he's saying, is like, whatever I have is from God. Right? And so this is a picture for us that whatever happens in our lives, whatever comes in our lives, whatever I have, whatever I don't have, God is in control. And if I truly trust in him, I trust in his control. I may not understand it. I may not like it. I may not get it. But I trust in his control. That everything I have is from God. Right? As we realize who God is, as we realize the truth of who he is, as we realize the truth of who Jesus is, because that's part of, I think, what's going on here, is his disciples are coming to him and like saying, hey, shouldn't you be jealous of this Jesus guy? And he's saying, no, I shouldn't be. Why? Because I recognize who he is, and I recognize that God is in control, and I recognize that what he's done, and so I trust in him. I trust in God. I trust in God's purposes. I trust in what God's done. I trust in what God's provided me. I trust in what God's doing over there with Jesus. I trust in God. Right? Trusting God doesn't mean that you're going to get everything's going to go how you want it to, that everything's going to work out, that you're even going to understand or anything. Like, there's things in my life, right, like that I go through, even like going through right now in my life, where it's like, I still don't get this. I don't understand what you're doing, God. I can wrestle with God. Like, why are you doing these things? But I choose to trust in him. Ultimately, God, you are good. You are wiser than me. You know better than me. How much conflict in our lives, whether it's within ourselves or with other people, would be avoided if we truly just walked in this principle that anything that someone has comes from God. How much more content would I be in my life? How much more hopeful would I be in my life? How much more joyful would I be in my life if I recognize that anything I have and don't have comes from God? And I trusted him in that. Sufficient faith trusts in God. John goes on and he says, the one who has the bride is the bridegroom. The friend of the bridegroom who stands and hears him rejoices greatly at the bridegroom's voice. You know what a bridegroom is? It's just a groom. I don't know why they translate as bridegroom. Rejoices at the groom's voice. Therefore, this joy of mine is now complete. He must increase, but I must decrease. And this is the kind of famous line of John the Baptist. When I think of John the Baptist, this is the that always comes to my mind is he must increase, I must decrease. And really, this is the cry of the heart of a follower of Jesus. This is the cry, I think, of sufficient faith. He must increase, I must decrease. And what I mean by that is I mean that what we get when we understand what it means to follow Jesus is that my life is not about myself. It's not about living for myself. It's not about pointing people to myself. It's not about gaining recognition, gaining status. It's not about gaining things for me. My life is about letting God increase in me. Right? I think there's two ways that this plays out. The first is just in self-denial. Right? I have things that I want. I have things that I desire. I have things that I think I need. But I find sometimes when I pursue those things, when I let my desires, when I let my emotions, when I let my will control my life, the ironic thing is as I pursue those things, I find that my life is less fulfilling, less meaningful, less joyful, right? That the things that I'm searching for, it's kind of like grasping onto sand that just falls through your fingertips. But that as I lose myself, as I forget the things that I want, and I look to him and the things that God tells me to desire, when I desire the things of him, when I pursue life his way, when I follow the desires that he has for me, that is when I find significance. That is when I find meaning. That is when I find fulfillment and joy in my life. That it's not about chasing the things I want. It's not about chasing my desires. But his desires, his mind must increase and mine must decrease. Right. This also comes out not just in our mentality, but also the ways that we live. That my actions transform as well. That I as I pursue him, that I want to be more like Jesus. That I want to love more like Jesus loved. That I want to lay down my life more like Jesus laid down his life. That I want to be more like Jesus is. And that as I do that in my life, that my life finds more purpose and meaning and fulfillment once again, that because Jesus is the perfect example of what it means to be a human, that as my life becomes more like him, as he increases, his spirit increases in me, and my spirit decreases in me, that I find that I live and find who I am supposed to be, right? It's this upside downness of God's kingdom, that as I seek myself, I actually don't find myself, and when I seek him, that's when I really find myself, really find who I'm supposed to be, is in him. He must increase, and I must decrease. So, all of that to say, forgot to put the point up there, sufficient faith rejoices at the work of Christ. And he gives an example here. He talks about this groom and the friend of the groom. We'll call him the best man. So the best man and the groom, right? And culturally, a best man was in charge, I guess, of planning lots of the wedding, of making sure everything was ready for the day, just making sure everything would goes well. Like that was the role of the best man, was to get the wedding ready, get the ceremony ready, get everything ready, make sure all the food, all the catering, whatever it had to be taken care of, right? That all of that was ready, that the groom could focus on marrying. There's a picture from our wedding that I really like. So this is our first kiss. My kids are going to really love that. That's up there too. but this is our first kiss after we're married. And you'll notice on the left-hand side, like with all the bridesmaids, so Anne's brother, I didn't really know, his name's Daniel, I didn't really know him very well at the time. And so instead of having him stand over at the groomsmen, we kind of decided, well, you know what? He's like, he's your brother. He's close to you. Like, why do we have to have him stand over on the other side? Like, why don't we have him stand by you? Like, it's kind of broke tradition there a little bit, but had him stand over there. And what I love about that picture is I love him peeking over. And what I love about this picture is, like, absolutely nobody that was at our wedding saw his joy, saw his delight as he's peeking over and watching us, because where was everybody's attention focused? On us, right? People had come to celebrate us, to celebrate our marriage, and everybody's attention was there. And yet, I love the little joy that you can see on Daniel's face as he peeks over, right? That because of the joy that we are experiencing, he is joyful because of that, right? The joy is not about him, everybody having attention on him and doing things for him, right? The joy that he's experiencing is because of the joy of the attention that we have, of the way that people are looking to us, and that he gets to be a part of that. And I think that's what John is getting at here when he talks about this whole thing with the groom and the friend of the groom, right? Is the idea is that the friend of the groom has given himself and given of himself and his life, not so that people will bring him joy, but so that he can provide joy to the groom, and in that, he finds joy. And that's the same thing that happens in our lives, as we look not to fulfill our own happiness, to fulfill our own satisfactions. We look not just to fulfill ourselves, but as we look as what what brings joy to God? What brings happiness there? What is going to build his kingdom? That as we look to those things, that we're like the groom planning the wedding, that our king, our groom has joy. And so we experience that joy secondhand, that we experience that joy from him. And so we're encouraged not just to seek what we want in life, but to seek what he wants, and that as we do, that is where we really find joy, is that sufficient faith rejoices at that work of Christ. The second thing is, next thing that John says is, he who comes from above is above all. He who is of the earth belongs to the earth and speaks in an earthly way. He who comes from heaven is above all. He bears witness to what he has seen and heard, yet no one receives his testimony. Whoever receives his testimony sets a seal to this, that God is true. For he whom God has sent others the words of God. For he gives the Spirit without measure. The Father loves the Son and has given all things into his hand. So this is kind of a little bit of a long passage here. But John compares two people there. He says, the one who comes from above, and who's he talking about there? Jesus. Yep, the one who comes from above, Jesus. And then the one who comes from the earth. So in context, who's the one who comes from the earth? John himself, right? He's comparing Jesus with himself. He's recognizing who Jesus is in comparison with who he is. And he sees several different things about him. So the first thing he says is that he comes from heaven. Now, we've talked about this several times throughout the book of John. I'm not going to get into this all the time. Again, you can go back to listen to some of the other messages. But talking about the uniqueness of Jesus, that Jesus has a unique relationship with God the Father because Jesus is God himself. And that the whole doctrine of the Trinity is hard for us to grasp and understand because we're finite beings dealing with talking about an infinite God. But by faith, once again, we assert that it's true, but we recognize that Jesus is unique in all of creation. And sufficient faith recognizes the uniqueness of Jesus. You are not God. I am not God. We do not have that relationship that Jesus has with God. We do not have that. We have a relationship with God. We have a deep relationship with God through Jesus, but we'll never have that same infinite type relationship, I don't believe, that Jesus has with God because he is uniquely God. He is the one from above. He is above all. All right, so that's the first thing that he recognizes here. The second thing he mentions is that God has placed all things in Jesus' hands, right? And there's a couple different things that points out to, but one of them is his power, that Jesus is powerful, right? God has placed all things to him. He talks about the power of the Spirit flowing through him, that Jesus is powerful in a way that you and I are not. One of my favorite passages in all of Scripture is the last few chapters of the book of Job. And I just read that sometimes when I'm just like, I don't know, just wanting to reflect on the worship of God and kind of diminish myself. And if you're not familiar with the passage, what it is Job has kind of been arguing with God, wrestling with God about the things that are going on in his life. And then God speaks to Job and he says to him, well, look at all of these things. Job, do you know, are you able to go to the ocean and say, your waves stop here? Are you able to see the storehouses of snow in the heavens? Are you able to know when each deer gives birth out in the fields? Job, are you able and powerful to do the things I do, to have the knowledge that I do? And of course, Job can do nothing but stand silent before God. And I love that passage of just talking about the power of God. And what this passage reminds us here in John is that God has placed all that power in the hands of Jesus, that Jesus is infinitely powerful the way that John is, right? That none of us can ever come close to the power of Jesus, right? Like, you know, we often, as Americans, we say, you know, like the American president, probably other people in the world say that the American president is the most powerful person in the world. Do you think that President Biden can go before Jesus and be like, aren't you impressed by me? Aren't you impressed? I command the U.S. military. Isn't that awesome? You think Jesus is impressed by that? right? Like the power of of the most powerful person is nothing compared to the power of Jesus. I heard Matt Chandler, preacher, say one time, he said, you know, no one goes before the Grand Canyon and says, well, I've got a PhD in advanced mathematics. Right? Like the power of God blows away any power that we have, any wisdom that we have, any knowledge that we have. The power, the might of God far exceeds any of that. And a faith that works in our heart that's sufficient for us to recognize who God is, recognizes his power. That's why John is able to trust in him. That's why John is able to say, whatever God gives, I'm okay with that, is because he recognizes the power of God. And then the last one is kind of tied to that power, but when we talk about having all things in his hands, is the authority. That sufficient faith recognizes the uniqueness, the power, and the authority of Jesus. Right? What authority do any of us have? Do any of us have the authority that commands the waves? Do any of us have the authority that commands the birds of the air? Do any of us have the same authority that God has? Right? I can't command the waves. I can't raise the dead. I'm doing good if I can raise my kids out of bed on time in the morning, right? Like I don't even really have that great of authority in my own household, let alone over all the universe. Who am I when I stand before an almighty God? Who am I when I stand in the presence of Jesus? Nothing. He must increase, I must decrease, because really there's not much me here in relation to him anyway. So, now this is the point I came up with here, is sufficient faith recognizes the uniqueness, power, and authority of Jesus. But as I was reflecting on this, if you've listened to my preaching for a while, and we talk about recognizing who we are in relation to recognizing who God is, what's the kind of more common biblical way to say that? Anybody? So it's a way we don't like, it's a word we don't like to say in relation to God and our culture. Huh? What'd you say, Cindy? Sovereignty? It has to do with God's sovereignty. But where I'm going with this is that sufficient faith fears God. Sufficient faith fears God. And right, and like I say, we don't really like to talk about that. Like, usually when we get to the passages where it talks about fearing God, I always give one of my introductions, like, the reason we go through a book of the Bible is because we have to talk about the things that we don't always like to talk about. And so I'm, like, bringing it up today, right? But the reason why is because this is what fearing God is. It is recognizing the power of God, recognizing the authority of God. It's recognizing the uniqueness of God, the holiness of God, recognizing all those things about him. And like John saying, there's a one that comes from heaven that's got all those things, and there's one that comes from earth, which is me, and I'm nothing in comparison with him. And so when we talk about this, the sufficient faith fears God, it's recognizing that he is unique. And why do I bring this up? It's because it's not a faith, when we talk about fear, it's not a fear that drives us away from God, but it's a fear that makes us think carefully about God, right? Like, I love hiking in the mountains. I love, like, going, you know, kayaking out on the ocean. I'm actually excited. I'm going to go rock climbing, I think, in a couple weeks with a friend. And I'm super excited for that. But I'm also, like, my mind, I keep thinking through, okay, like, all right, is all my gear good? Like, it's a little bit old. Do I need to get some new stuff to be safer? Am I ready for this kind of trip? Like all these things are going through my mind. Why do I go through those things? Fear. And is it good for me to go through those things? Yeah, it is, because what happens if I don't? Splat, right? right? I don't want to die. I don't want a fear that drives me away from the mountains. I don't want a fear that drives me away from doing those things. I want a fear that helps me approach those things rightly, that helps me approach those things safely, that helps me approach those things in a way where I can experience them to the fullest. And so when we talk about fearing God, that is what we're talking about, and that is why I even bring it into this message, right? Proverbs 9, it says, the fear of Yahweh is the beginning of wisdom. right? Recognizing who God is and his significance and his power and his glory, and recognizing who I am and my insignificance and my weakness and my whatever the opposite of glory is the first step in being able to live my life rightly. And so I don't fear God in a way that makes me not want to be around God or that makes me draw away from God, but I fear God in a way that helps me to approach him rightly, to recognize that as I come in the presence of God, as I see what Jesus has done to be able to allow me to come in the presence of God, that this is an amazing, wonderful thing, and I don't just take it for granted. I don't just take it casually, but I see it for the wonder that it is. A sufficient faith stirs our hearts to fear God properly, to recognize him and his beauty and his grandness and his glory, and to say, I want to approach him rightly. Sufficient faith stirs our hearts in that way. Then we have this verse at the end, and it says, whoever believes in the Son has eternal life. Whoever does not obey the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God remains on him. Now, we talk about the wrath of God. Once again, we talked about this. I brought in this idea of fear. I was like, oh, wait, isn't this what fear of God is? We're supposed to be fearing the judgment of God. And I'm actually not going to spend a long time on the wrath of God. I kind of talked about that last week. I'd encourage you to go back and listen to that. If you weren't here, we'll do a summary, because lots of people won't go back and listen. Is kind of the short version of what we said is that we talked about that God loves his creation, wants to save his creation, wants to make right, wants to bring light to the darkness, just like we all long to live in a world without darkness. God longs for that too. And he's angry about what's gone on in his creation, just like we get angry when we see people act wickedly and evil in the world. And so he wants to set that right, and that we've contributed to that wickedness, we've contributed to that evil in that world, and so we are under that wrath, but that because of God's love for us, what we read last week, this is the way that God loved us, is that he sent his Son to rescue us out of that wrath, to rescue us out of that judgment, and to save us and bring us into his kingdom. And so that is what this is talking about here, is that wrath remains on us if we don't trust in the salvation of God, the salvation that he offers, if we don't accept the rescue that he has for us, that wrath remains on us. But that's not really where I want to focus with this. Yeah, like just as we read last week, I do want to just bring this verse back into our minds. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. This reminds us that this is God's intention is not just to come with wrath upon us just because he's like angry that we don't believe in him, but his hope is not that we would be objects of that wrath, but that he would save us out of it, that we would accept the salvation that he offers us in Jesus. But this verse does make clear that if we continue to define right and wrong on our own terms, if we continue to live for our own ways and not God's ways, if we continue to act selfishly in our self-interest and at the expense of others, that God's wrath remains on us. And if you struggle with that, listen to last week's message. But I don't think that John is really trying to scare anyone here. I think we actually miss the point here a little bit. And to kind of illustrate this, we're going to play a little game. It's a pretty easy game. It's called opposites. So the opposite of tall, what is the opposite of tall?
Short.
There we go. Opposite of tall and short is short. That's Shaq and Simone Biles, if you don't know who those people are. Mm-hmm. All right, you guys are pretty good at this. What's the opposite of dark? Light or bright? Dark, light or bright. Opposite of big? Little. Uh-huh. The opposite of disappointing? Exciting. How did that one get in there? I made that joke before. The Royals just went on a 7-game losing streak and may miss the playoffs. But all right, the opposite of weak? Strong? Huh? All right. The opposite of disobey? Obey. The opposite of believe? Disbelieve or doubt? So that is interesting, right? We all know those opposites. It's pretty intuitive. Now let's go back to this verse here and see what John does. He says, whoever believes in the Son has eternal life, but whoever, we would expect him to say, what? Does not believe. Because those are the opposites. Or we'd expect him to say, whoever obeys the Son has eternal life, but whoever does not obey the Son shall not see life. Right? He's contrasting two things, and we read it quickly, and we miss that these two things are not intuitive opposites. Now, I read this, actually, even when I used to read this, and even when I was going into this week, I was kind of thinking one thing about this passage, and then I kind of came to a realization of something else. I used to approach this like, well, what he's saying here is that, you know, we believe in God, but belief leads to obedience, right? As I believe in Jesus, I obey him because I trust him, right? And belief is trust, and so as I trust Jesus, I obey him. And there's a part of truth to that. We're going to get to another verse in John that says something kind of like that. But I don't think that's the point of this. As I was pondering and studying and praying on this passage week, I actually don't think that's the part of it. That's what John is saying here. All right, who here has ever disobeyed God? Like, you knew what God wanted of you, and you said, I'm not going to do that, I'm going to do what I want. No, all of us here, right? Who here has ever disobeyed God? All of us. Now, none of us, if we experience the, according to this verse, none of us, if we experience the anger, the wrath, the judgment of God, none of us have anyone to blame but ourselves, right? We knew what was wrong. It's like my kids sometimes, I'll punish them. Not these two, the other two that aren't in the room, right? I punish them for something. And then they're mad at me, and I'm like, why are you mad at me? You knew what was right, it was wrong. You knew that punishment would come if you did this. Why are you mad at me, right? And we can get mad at God, but when we are recognize who he is and his justice and all those things, none of us have anyone to blame but ourselves if we face the wrath or the judgment of God, right? All of us have disobeyed. But God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world. And how did Jesus save the world? By doing what we could not. By obeying. Right? Jesus obeyed. You know, if, like, no matter who is in this room and I ask that question, who here has ever disobeyed God? Some people may not recognize that they disobeyed God, but every hand should go up that everyone has disobeyed God in some way. To whatever knowledge they have of God and his law, the law is written on our hearts, scripture says, every hand would go up in all of history except for one, right? If Jesus Christ were in this room right now in the flesh, like, he would be the only one not to raise his hand because he was the only one who was perfectly obedient to God. He did what we could not. And so when it says, whoever does not obey the Son shall not see life, that's all of us. But whoever believes in the Son, the contrast there is not between our belief and our disobedience. The contrast is between Jesus' obedience and our disobedience. Right? Huh? You believe in the Son? Me too, buddy. Good. I'm glad to hear that, Soren. Me too. The contrast is between our disobedience and Jesus' obedience. Right? Because of the obedience of Jesus, I have eternal life. And once again, we talked the last few weeks, eternal life's not just life forever, but it's like a different type of greater life that we have. Go back and listen to those messages to get that. But we have that eternal life because of the obedience of Jesus. And all I have to do is to trust in that obedience. Whoever trusts in the obedience of the Son has eternal life, right? Because I'm never going to be able to obey. He can increase and I can decrease. And even though in my life, like, he has increased lots and I have decreased lots, I still have times that I disobey. I still have times where I not just accidentally sin, but willfully sin. All right? He has increased a lot and I have decreased and I still can stumble. And yet I'm confident that I have eternal life not because he has increased enough that I obey, but because I trust in his obedience. That he has rescued me out from the wrath that I deserve, from the judgment, the punishment that I deserve, that he has saved me out of that, and I walk in him, and I trust, and I have confidence in him. And so sufficient faith trusts in the obedience of Jesus. God's heart is not to punish us, to get us to, you know, to get you, and that's not what we mean when we say fear God. Like, we recognize that God's just judgment is good and fair, but his heart is to save us from that wrath that we deserve. And he did, and in order to accomplish that, he came and obeyed where we could not. He came and obeyed to the point of death, even death on a cross, as Paul says. He went to that great length so that we could experience that eternal life. And all that it demands is that I trust in that work. Now, one last thing I want to go back to here. So, how did this whole discussion between John and his disciples, how did it start off? What was the debate over? Purification. And we said, never read of anything else about purification. But what's interesting about this, and then the other thing is what did John compare himself to? And that little metaphor he used in the middle there? The groom, right? He compared himself to the friend of the groom, to the best man of the groom. What's interesting is that this language is used all throughout Scripture. So I'm going to read one more passage here. This is from the book of Ephesians. And Paul says this, "Husbands, love your wives, just as Christ loved the church and gave himself for her to make her holy, cleansing her with the washing of water by the word. He did this to present the church to himself in splendor, without spot or wrinkle or anything like that, but holy and blameless." So, what is purification? Purification is being made cleansed, being made ready to come into the presence of God. And what this passage tells us, what we look forward to in the book of Revelation, speaks of is the marriage of the Lamb, the marriage of Jesus with the church, that we are the bride of Christ. That he is at work purifying us by the washing us, cleansing with the word, washing by water, to present himself, to present us to him as a bride. Now, I've never been a bride on a wedding day, but so I was just at a wedding yesterday, even at my wedding there. Who were people more paying attention to? The bride, right? It's like, it's the bride. I was excited. I was joyful. People were joyful for me. I'm not like saying it's like the groom doesn't care. Obviously, they do, but it's something unique and exciting that happens with that bride. That joy that's there. And what this says, what this passage reminds us, what when we use this message of the wedding, when we use this metaphor in script, when Scripture uses metaphor, is that Jesus is creating our joy for us. That Jesus is at work perfecting our joy, that as we come into union with him as his bride, as his church, as we come to him, that we are filled with joy. And John is saying, I just want to prepare the church for that. I just want to prepare the church for her husband. That's the most exciting thing for me, is to see the joy of the church as is prepared by Jesus. And I don't think I'm saying this very well as I'm saying it out loud, but I hope you guys can kind of get the point of what I'm getting at here, is that Jesus' joy is in joining us with him and seeing the joy that comes from that. That he has rescued us from sin and shame and death. He's rescued us from wrath and judgment. And he's brought us not just into this other place where it's like, well, you don't have to experience that, but where we can experience the joy that a bride feels on her wedding day, the joy of a new life beginning together, the joy of happiness, that he has prepared us for that. That our groom has loved us so much that he has given himself for us, that he has obeyed where we could not, that he has made us clean by his death, that he has given himself to us so that we can rejoice, that his blood has been poured out so that we can drink the cup of celebration as the bride of Christ eternally worshiping and joyful in our groom. Jeff and Annika, would you guys be willing to come help hand this out? And so as we come to the communion table today, let's rejoice at the joy that we have as the bride of Christ. Let's rejoice in what Jesus has accomplished. And let's let that faith stir in our hearts that says, he must increase and I must decrease. So you can come, take some bread, take some juice, take it back to your seat and hold it, and we'll take it together in just a couple of minutes.
Was lost, I walked away. The road was dark, I could not see. My hope was gone, the pain was real, but your mercy. You saw my steps, you felt my tears, you heard my cries, you caught my tears. Arms open wide, you ran to me with your mercy. Your mercy, I stand before my King and bow my heart to sing. You save me, you raise me, you died so I could live. No greater love than this, your mercy. You give me life beyond the grave. My deepest shame is cast away. You sing a song that covers me, and it's your mercy. Your mercy, your mercy. I stand before my King and bow my heart to sing your mercy.
Thunder. Praise the Lord, for the Lord our God, the Almighty, reigns. Let us be glad and rejoice, and let us give honor to him. For the time has come for the wedding feast of the Lamb, and his bride has prepared herself. She's been given the finest of pure white linen to wear, for the fine linen represents the good deeds of God's holy people. And the angel said to me, write this, blessed are those who are invited to the wedding feast of the Lamb. And he added, these are true words that come from God. God, we thank you that we rejoice as your bride, that we have been made clean, that as we have trusted and put our faith in you, that you have worked in us. God, we thank you for your your power, your authority, for your holiness, your uniqueness. We thank you that we can trust in you. And we thank you for the cross that seals and points to all of those things. We take this bread and we say, thank you for the trust that we have in your obedience and in your work. And as we take this cup, God, and we even think of the symbolism of taking your blood, God, of you coming into us, God, we ask that you would increase in us, that your mindset would increase in us, that your desires would increase in us, that your works would increase us, and that we would decrease, that we would become more like you, Jesus. We take this cup and we say, work in our lives. Make us who we are supposed to be in you. And so, God, I ask by your Spirit to be at work in us. Give us a faith that trusts you the way that John trusts you. A faith that sees you for all who you are. A faith that really fears you and recognizes your glory. And is not afraid to come to you, God, but approaches you for all who you are and sees you for all who you are in your fullness, God. We thank you for the blood of Jesus that allows us to approach you. May we continue to be in your presence as your people. In Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Grace be with you all.